Next on Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
Are you a retired professional sitting around doing nothing, bored with inactivity, anxious to get involved? Well, listen to this. Write to Temple University's Association for Retired Professionals. A small annual fee will open the doors for you to enjoy classes all day, every day. Languages, current affairs, history, art, music, no grades, no examinations. Get all the facts by writing to Temple University Association for Retired Professionals, Center City, Philadelphia, 19103.
Evening Magazine lights up the Delaware Valley. On the next Evening Magazine, meet a blind private detective who won't allow his handicap to end his work. You'll also meet folk singer Joan Baez, who has traded the protests of the 60s for a new lifestyle today. Evening Magazine, tonight at 7 on Channel 3.
Gee, I didn't feel a thing. Oh, aren't they pretty?
Ear piercing and earrings, just $8.99 complete at Gimbels this Thursday, Friday, and Saturday only.
This is KYW-TV, Channel 3, Philadelphia.
Channel 3 Eyewitness News, the sights and sounds of today. The Delaware Valley's most complete television news service with Roy Weissinger and Jessica Savitch. Now for the Eyewitness News team, here is Jessica Savitch.
And here's what's happening. Pennsylvania state government is at a standstill right now. Thousands of workers took to the streets in major cities to protest that lack of a budget, a problem that's kept them from getting paid. And in Harrisburg, right at this moment, the state legislature is wrestling, as it has been for several weeks now, trying to pass a budget. The House is expected to formally meet sometime around 7 p.m. State police moved into state prisons and hospitals today to replace workers who are missing. And for some employees, it has been 5 weeks without a paycheck. $61.5 million in wages have not been paid in Pennsylvania. The Philadelphia demonstration started at Broad and Girard, and Charles Bierbauer and our Instant Eye were there.
The demonstration started here in North Philadelphia as a not very dramatic and sometimes disorganized rally. There were some 500 people, welfare workers and welfare recipients, who together are suffering through the Pennsylvania budget crisis. At the rally, Milton Street, a black activist, told them it is time to get mad. And as the rally moved down Broad Street, it got louder and madder. They stopped at the state office building, where some state employees stayed on the job, and others, hoping to shut down the government, had not. But the rally had another dimension as it moved to City Hall to demand that Mayor Rizzo do something to end the Harrisburg budget stalemate.
All the people that put him in office, just in case he thinks he can run again, they're watching to see whether he can do anything.
I think he should help us try to get back to school, because education is really important to us now, and I hope he realized that us black kids out here need the education.
And I understand it was like a joke to him about what's happening in Harrisburg. It's no joke to the state workers. They have children that needs to be fed. It's no joke to us welfare recipients.
City Hall was ringed by police, but the mayor was not in. A delegation met with Managing Director Hillel Levinson, who promised help to provide food and fight evictions, but basically Levinson said the Harrisburg crisis had not been caused by the city of Philadelphia.
The Harrisburg situation is one that, we have, like I say, tried everything we possibly can in working with the holdouts at the present time. The leadership up in Harrisburg has tried everything they possibly can.
The people got a meeting with city officials, perhaps not the one that they wanted with the mayor. They got some answers, probably not the ones they really wanted. I'm Charles Bierbauer, Channel 3 Eyewitness News at City Hall.
Behind the demonstration was a coordinated campaign by state workers and civic groups to keep state employees off the job. A sound truck had gone through sections of Philadelphia urging full participation in the sick out. At the state office building, Malcolm Poindexter found a small delegation of union representatives who had just succeeded in turning away 5 employees of the welfare office. Other employees stayed off the job voluntarily. And for a conservative office that was not expected to go along with the sick out program, it was an unexpected victory, as Malcolm Poindexter reported to us.
Well, we'd say 20 to 30% just didn't show up, and the other 10% we were able to turn back.
What do you think this is going to mean as far as the legislature is concerned?
Well, the idea of being out here, we hope it's effective enough to make to put pressure on the legislature to make them pass this budget, because we haven't been paid for over 3 weeks now.
Well, the situation in western Pennsylvania is pretty grim at this hour, Jess. The walkout by state workers devastated operations in jails and hospitals and state office buildings. And Jay Scott of our sister station in Pittsburgh, KDKA, is standing by live to bring us up to date on the problem. Jay?
Right. Here in the Pittsburgh area, there was a gathering air of crisis today as thousands of state workers, including guards at several area prisons and various aides at state hospitals, failed to appear for work. Now, state troopers have taken over for the prison guards in most cases, stretching thin an already haggard and also unpaid Troop B here. Despite the job actions, however, as far as we can tell right now, there has been only one arrest in the region as far as the picket lines are concerned. Eyewitness News reporter Andy Gastmeyer has more now from the state office building here in Pittsburgh and the situation in general.
The story at the state office building, empty chairs, a lot of empty chairs. Of the roughly 1,300 employees who work here, it appeared that no more than a fourth of that number showed up. Those who did consisted mainly of PSSU members, management personnel, and non-union workers. Those AFSCME people who did report were reluctant to be photographed, some saying they didn't want to be docked a day's pay. Here in the Southern District Office of the Department of Welfare, 22 clerical workers failed to show up. Two floors below in the office for the Western region of the Department of Welfare, there was little evidence of a sick out. Most of the people here are PSSU members and management personnel. But they have jurisdiction over the residents and state hospitals in a 23-county area. And as word of the extent of the sick out filtered down to them, they became concerned about the welfare of the patients in those hospitals. James Neiman, director of the regional office, says some institutions, Western Center, for example, were reporting some difficulty. But according to Deputy Welfare Secretary Annabelle Calloway, they still have the manpower to get through the crisis.
We are managing to care for those within our institutions using those staff who have come in and also using some management staff from this office and the volunteers who are coming into the various facilities throughout the region.
In the Bureau of Motor Vehicles, not only did most of the staff fail to show up, but the public as well.
Approximately 50% of our employees have come to work today. The remainder are on sick leave or emergency annual leave in sympathy with the other personnel here in the state office building who have not received their paychecks. Naturally, I'm quite disappointed in the ones in my office who have taken off because they are paid under the motor license fund budget and they have received their pays.
Mrs. Knoll said that because of media coverage, many people thought the state office building would be closed today, and therefore they stayed away. And so might she add, to the state office workers. Andy Gastmeyer, Eyewitness News.
Right, that's pretty much the story from here in western Pennsylvania. Safe to say it's pretty grim here also.
Jay, what do your sources say about when this might end?
Well, the job action for our region, at least, was supposed to be a day-long affair, but, you know, with so many people involved, it's hard to tell whether or not the AFSCME organizers will be able to call them off at the end of the day.
Okay, Jay Scott in Pittsburgh, thank you for your report. And the Pennsylvania House is supposed to try again and pass a state budget. That's supposed to come up tonight. Dick Sheeran and Harrisburg Bureau Chief Sandy Starobin have been there all day. They were there last night to watch the budget go down to defeat again. And, gentlemen, what happened?
Well, Roy, you've heard of the expression George Washington slept here. Well, these gentlemen, three Republicans, Paul Wass, Gene Giese, and John Davies, all slept here last night, and they've been here all day as a protest because nothing is being done in the House of Representatives. Your question, what is happening? Take a look. Nothing. They were supposed to be back here at 3 o'clock. The Democrats, quite frankly, are still looking for two more votes. They need 102. They had 100 last night. Sandy, are they going to find them?
Well, they're certainly putting the arm on those two votes. It may even take a congressional nomination to get them, but they are working.
Okay. Roy?
I've got so many obvious questions, I don't know where to start, but what do we hear about tonight, gentlemen? Are we going to get any action tonight?
Are we going to get any action tonight? That is a very good question. Unless they find the two votes, they're not going to come back to the floor. That's the strategy, right, Sandy?
That's exactly true. They're not going to let this budget fail again.
But the last time they did vote, about 5 minutes to one this morning, the instant I and your crew went into action, and that's when the shifting rules of the House of Representatives also went into action, and they wound up actually going against us.
5 votes. It is shortly before 1 o'clock in the morning. There has been almost 3 hours of debate on this point. We are now being ejected from the House of Representatives. As the dramatic vote comes, they are closing the door. Because, Mr. Speaker, can we have some sort of an explanation for being thrown out after covering this debate for days and spending literally thousands of dollars to tell the people in Philadelphia and Pittsburgh what's going on, that at the key time we were rudely thrown off the floor and the door shut in our face?
In the first place, I'm not going to answer your question if you phrase it as being rudely thrown out. In my opinion, you weren't rudely thrown out. In my opinion, you rudely intruded on the floor of the House, and it's my duty to maintain the decorum in the floor of the House. As long as I'm a speaker in the floor of the House, it will be maintained. If any television crew, yours or anyone else's, violates what I consider the decorum of the floor, you will be removed.
Well, what
Does
about
that answer
the,
your question?
What about the idea that public television is rolling and we're here too? Is that fair?
Public television is an arm of this government. Public television is invited into the floor of the House by reason of the rules of the House. Commercial television, that television which is organized for profit, is in at the sufferance of the House. And I may say this to you, sir, the House's patience has suffered just about as far as it's going to suffer. And if I, certain things which I noticed happened on the floor of the House the last 2 days continues, my assumption is that the members of the House will do more than write protests to me. They will demand that all of you remain off the floor.
Now, that interview took place early this morning. Later this afternoon, Speaker Irvis apologized for throwing us out or ordering us thrown out. He said, as far as he's concerned, he welcomes full coverage. He said some other members, though, are objecting to television coverage, and when we find out, especially the Philadelphians, we'll let you know who they are.
Okay, gentlemen. Thank you very much, Sandy Starobin and Dick Sheeran in Harrisburg. And Jess, our look at key stories around the world tonight takes us to Indonesia, St. Louis, and Minneapolis.
Roy, in Minneapolis, doctors say Hubert Humphrey spent a comfortable night and is in good spirits today following an operation that showed he has terminal cancer. His doctors say he needed very little medication and insisted on weighing himself when he got up. It's possible the senator could be out of the hospital in a week and right back in the Senate by early September. In St. Louis, 4 people, including 2 sisters, were found shot to death today in 2 neighboring suburban homes. Police say it appears to be a case of triple murder and suicide. In Indonesia, a strong earthquake and a small tidal wave struck the eastern part of the country this afternoon, but officials say there are no reports of deaths or damage as of yet. Bill Custer is on vacation this week, and so once again it is my turn to give the weather. Today's high was 78 degrees, the low was 58, and presently it is 76 degrees. Nice day down at the shore. The air temperature is 75 degrees, water 66. The winds are out of the west at 6 miles per hour. Tonight will be cloudy with a low of 58, and tomorrow cloudy again, a high of 76 degrees. And how is that state workers' walkout affecting operations at state hospitals? We'll find out.
But next on Eyewitness News, we'll find out how police deal with crime against the elderly.
Every so often, Exxon dealers go back to school.
Now, in the radial tire structure,
they learn about important things.
Uniflow is a super premium oil.
Like Exxon product quality. And even little things, like showing appreciation for your business.
Have a nice day.
Good to see you.
Thanks for coming by.
Exxon and Exxon dealers like to do more than sell you dependable products. They want you to know they're glad you came.
Thanks for coming by.
Some people carry American Touristers very light because it's beautiful. Some carry the very light because it's roomy. And then there are people who carry the very light because it's very light.
On sale right now at all Strawbridge and Clothier stores.
Criminals like easy victims, and the elderly are often easy marks. In tonight's Impact Report, Don Fair looks at crime and
they're
the elderly.
Alone. They use public transportation or they walk because they can't afford a car. They have poor eyesight. Maybe their hearing is failing. They move a lot slower than they did. They just don't have the strength they used to. The they of this Impact Week, are the seniors of this country, and they are becoming the most victimized group in the land.
It was raining, and during the time that I was walking down the street, the umbrella kind of hit my arm, and someone ran up and back of me and snatched my purse. But when he did that, I wasn't upset. I was angry. I was so angry.
Getting angry is the logical reaction, but really doesn't do very much about catching a purse snatcher or mugger. Pianist Ronnie Morris didn't call the police right away. She waited nearly a day, giving the culprit a chance to leave a trail that was impossible to pick up. The senior citizens' crime problem in this country is finally getting the attention it should. Federal money's being used to set up crime prevention programs nationwide. In the city of Philadelphia, the Community Relations Unit of the police is focusing its attention on the problem this year. And community centers like St. Rita's is also doing what it can.
Usually we try and schedule in the center programming someone from either a safety organization or from the police to come in a couple of times a year. And then during that time, we ourselves, myself or other members of the staff, may talk to the people. And if we see something happening, that, you know, we'll make them more aware.
But it's more than just crimes of bloodshed. The seniors are easily victimized by ripoffs and con games. It's a big problem that some call a crisis, but there are places like St. Rita's that are doing things in their own way to at least hold the line on senior citizen crime.
Safety programs are presented here all the time, but a program just begun here at the center, first in the city of Philadelphia, gets senior citizens and young people together. The organizers feel that if potential criminals and potential victims get to know each other better, maybe the problem won't be so bad. I'm Don Fair, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
The YMYWHY will present a folk guitar concert for the Jewish Singles Group at Broad and Pine Streets on August 24th. That concert starts at 7:30 p.m. Dozens of workers at Pennhurst State School and Hospital called in sick today to protest the budget crisis, but Robin Mackintosh found this sick out might do more good than harm.
Unlike others hurt by the budget impasse in Harrisburg, many of these mentally retarded patients at Pennhurst don't understand about sick outs or political pressure, but they do know when a familiar face isn't there. And today, 50% of the staff called in sick. This week, there are 1,200 patients here, and even though administrators, doctors, and nurses tried to fill in, many of the patients knew it wasn't a normal day. To help ease the situation, Pennhurst spent the day asking for outside volunteers to help.
People are starting to arrive today, and we're starting to place them in areas of critical need, and also having them move out into areas just to interact with the residents, take them out for the day since it's a rather nice day.
Hearing music from a place like Ward 47 in the middle of a budget crisis seemed out of place, but Audrey Ludwiz is a summer volunteer here. She spends 3 days a week working with patients for free.
I really enjoy it. I've been doing it all summer, and it's a very rewarding experience for me.
You recommend it to other people to come out?
I think anybody that has any interest in people in general should come down and help.
If there's a positive side to this one-day sick out, it's that dozens of people are calling Pennhurst to volunteer their time. But officials say those volunteers are needed more than just one day a year. They're needed year-round. People like Audrey Ludwiz, who just want to help people. I'm Robin Mackintosh, Channel 3 Eyewitness News at Pennhurst Center.
Coming up, Tony Hernandez takes to the high seas
and
again.
And he comes back with a recipe for what he says is a great fish dish, and we'll tell you how to prepare it when Eyewitness News moves on.
The ankle-length red chiffon culotte by Casper for Joan Leslie. The furniture by N.B. Liebman. The cling peach matte jersey jumpsuit by Francis Hannigan. The sectional sofa and accent pieces by N.B. Liebman. The Levi's by Levi. The rest of the room and the best of any room by N.B. Liebman.
You may know that Sugar Twin looks, tastes, measures, and pours like table sugar.
But did you know that Sugar Twin is accepted by the Advertising Committee of the American Diabetes Association? Together, Sugar Twin and the Diabetes Association have prepared this booklet to help millions of people who may have diabetes. Look for the booklet wherever you find Sugar Twin, the light, light sweetener with only 1.5 skinny calories per teaspoon that's accepted by the Advertising Committee of the American Diabetes Association.
I hope you don't mind, Ken, but I asked Mary what people do when they reach the age where, you know, they occasionally have a problem with constipation. And do you know what she said? Haley's M.O.
Haley's M.O., a good-tasting laxative lubricant formula that also softens. Proven in 2 hospital studies to be a most effective medicine for constipation.
How are you this morning, dear?
I'm okay. When constipation's occasionally a problem, Haley's M.O. is a most effective medicine. I'm okay.
It's time to go fishing again, and we go dining as well tonight as Tony Hernandez concludes his series of reports on fishing.
As we begin the end of this series, special credit must be given here to cameraman George Dolan, sound man Dave West, tape editor Russell Freeman, of course to Mr. and Mrs. Frank Fagel, and to captain's mate Bob D'Orazio. This week, we pointed out some of the better spots for fishing off the Jersey coast, as well as some of the better techniques for catching such fish as blues, flounder, and weakfish. And we learned how to cook some of those fish, which is also the subject of today's final report. Specifically, how to prepare stuffed bluefish. The chef, once again, is the captain's wife, Jerry Fagel.
You take a pound of crab meat, and to that you add 2 eggs. And you mix it up with your fork. Okay, to the crab meat you would add 1 cup of breadcrumbs. Mixed up real good. Then you would take your onion, a small onion, dice it up, mix that up. Take your fish, light in the baking pan, then you take your crab meat and fill the fish. You don't need too much crab meat for this. Then you would roll it and lay it on your cookie sheet or your pan. You would take a can of cream of celery soup and you would pour that over top. Bake it for 1 hour at 325. Mm-hmm. And that's all you have to do.
Okay. Well, it's been a long, hard day of fishing, but now comes the real fun part, the acid test. The tasting of the stuffed bluefish.
Mmm. Magnifique. I wish all of you happy fishing, and better still, happy eating. This is Tony Hernandez for Channel 3 Eyewitness News. Mm. Good.
As many of you already know, tonight is Jessica Savitch's last program with Eyewitness News. Starting next week, she will be with NBC in Washington and will also be seen anchoring from New York.
Yes, Roy, it has come to that portion of this particular broadcast they have labeled Savitch Farewell. This will be my final broadcast as an employee of KYW Television. Beginning in 2 weeks, I will take an assignment with NBC Network News. And since KYW is one of the stations across the United States that carries NBC News programs, my reports will continue to air right here on Channel 3. And what that means is that I find myself in the unique position of leaving and staying at the same time. The standard script on an occasion such as this one calls for you to thank everyone on the personal as well as the professional level who made it all possible. And I'm also told this script should be brief. That means you are charged with the awesome task of saying next to nothing and meaning almost everything. I've long been a believer in using the public airwaves for messages meant only for the public. And so all of those colleagues and friends and associates and the people I love who did indeed make this last 5 years in Philadelphia personally possible for me, all of those people, I have personally thanked. And that leaves only one thank you left, the thank you that I have saved to fill the time the station has graciously allotted me. And that thank you is for you. There were times when we did well, and I would so much wish that you were watching. And there were times it wasn't so good, and I'd wish you'd blink. And I have to admit, there were times I almost didn't believe you were out there at all. And then every once in a while, into this horizontal, vertical, 3x4, two-dimensional box of a world through which I'm required to communicate information, there would come a letter, or a phone call, a word on the street, or even just a feeling. And I would know that there was indeed a third dimension, that the message was received and the cycle complete, and that you were really out there after all. That's what I thought about as I labored to fill out the slot labeled Savitch Farewell. Not that this job meant almost everything to me for the last 5 years, but that somewhere in that time, it may have meant something to you. You made it all worthwhile, and I do thank you.
Well, we all wish Jess the best when she joins NBC, and we here at Eyewitness News have put together some of the highlights of Jessica's career at Channel 3.
I was afraid. Now here's what's happening.
I don't mean the series to frighten you. On the contrary.
I'll be taking a close-up look at Philadelphia Rock.
Police training is rugged and demanding, but then so is the job. Join me in training, on patrol, and in two major cities where it seems to be working.
We don't promise you any answers in this series, just some information from experts and from people like yourselves you might want to consider before making a decision of life and death. Tomorrow, a look at how couples prepare to share the natural high of childbirth.
Philadelphia traditions, Philadelphia neighborhoods, and Philadelphia people have been a part of Hollywood ever since all of those cattle feedlots became studio lots feeding entertainment to a nation.
You can always tell a Philadelphian, and you can always tell if he's eating cupcakes.
Goodbye, my sister, please don't let me see you cry. Gonna be a star someday, no matter what they say.
Well, Jessica was a typical teenager. I'm sure she had her excitable moments in high school, not always the calm person she appears on TV.
Really, I really wanted to look pretty, too.
One other item of note, Bill Custer, pay attention. For almost the first time in 5 years, I found out Jessica Savitch has ears.
This could definitely mess up a hairdo.
No kidding. What should I do about my hair? Either I could get a new hairdo or I could change direction. That's worse.
Sophisto evening lady of the air. Welcomes me in my easy chair. Green eyes that glow and yellow blonde hair, making the bad news sound good. I wish you'd come and cover me.
Sorry I can't be with you on your last broadcast on Channel 3 News. But even on videotape, it's difficult to say goodbye to someone with whom you've worked so closely for 5 years. We are pleased, though, that you are joining NBC so we can at least claim you as a member of our team. No one in Philadelphia TV has achieved more in such a short period of time. Needless to say, we're very proud of you. I wish you the best in the years to come. Good luck.
I don't care if that isn't right. We're not doing it again.
Thank you. What can I say after I've said thank you? That was...
Good luck. You're going to
Roy,
be just great.
Thank you so much. People at Channel 3 are really terrific, and I'm really happy that we're going to turn the show over to Roy and that Vince did that, and you're all great, and I better be quiet.
Okay, let's go to Jack Jones, who's standing by for the 6 o'clock edition. Jack.
Yes, good luck to you. A police shootout in Hatboro, a robbery suspect is killed. We have an instant eye report, and at least one person is dead in the crash of a light plane near Morrisville, Pennsylvania. And our live exclusive coverage from Harrisburg continues on the Battle of the Budget. The full story's next, right here on Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
Gimbels time.
Time to save on Serta Designer's Choice.
On sale in every size and every firmness.
Every twin, $69 mattress or foundation.
In every style, from quilted prints to damask.
Saturday only at Gimbel's Market East and all great Gimbels.
$69, even ortho firm.
That's hard.
Every size, Serta Designer's Choice on sale. Even the three-piece king set is just $2.99.
When it's time to save on Serta, it's...
Gimbel's time.
Everybody loves Mike.
I love him.
I love him.
Everybody loves Mike.
Mike, there are two things I like to do every day. One is ride my bike. The other is watch Mike. I love him.
Everybody loves Mike.
Join Mike and co-host Kate Jackson Monday at 4. They're here, the new Party Summer Lights, sparkling Caton Pale Dry Ginger Ale and Tonic Water, and lively Blue Sparkler Club Soda, now at popular prices at your favorite dealer. This is Channel 3, KYW-TV, Philadelphia.
Channel 3 Eyewitness News, the sights and sounds of today. The Delaware Valley's most complete television news service with Vince Leonard and Jack Jones. Now, for Eyewitness News, here is Jack Jones.
Vince is on vacation. Here is what's happening. Thousands of Pennsylvania state workers are suffering from a severe case of budgetitis tonight. The illness spread throughout the state, brought on by payless paydays, and apparently the only cure is a new state budget out of Harrisburg. The sick out involved welfare workers, prison guards, and other state employees. We'll take you to Pittsburgh for a report on the impact of the sick out there. We'll also go to Harrisburg on a live report on the budget battle. But first, Charles Bierbauer reports on the instant eye that fears of violence are growing the longer we go without a budget.
Talk to people in this crowd of demonstrators.